This-to-day session is for drinking water and wastewater analysis with modern photometric methods. You can see my name. My name is Gunter Decker. I'm a senior manager, a subject matter expert. Well, what Asanka already said, for the point of view is analytics. So this means entire photometry, which we have under the Merck responsibility, including the test kits for water, wastewater, food and beverage analysis, including everything. And I'm located in Darmstadt, the headquarter of Merck KGaA in Germany. When we look for the agenda today, we will have a short, brief overview about wastewater analysis, and I will give some examples for limits. Therefore, I have chosen something interesting for you also. We will have a short look, very brief, into the drinking water analysis. Then I will explain also about normative methods and rapid methods, what are the differences, how to understand the spectroquant chemistry, because it is very important. Then we will talk about the instrument itself. Then we have some examples also, which I have chosen for wastewater analysis and for drinking water analysis. And then we have a short conclusion. This presentation will take around 80 minutes, so 70 to 80 minutes. So we have another 30 minutes for question and answers. So when you have something what you would like to ask, please put this into the chat. We will not forget it. We will answer all the questions. So we have plenty of time. Let's have a look into wastewater analysis. As I said, I want to give you some examples from limits. And therefore, I have chosen, as we are in Southeast Asia, I have chosen here some information which I could find here from Pakistan. I was a couple of times there already for business reasons. Also, we have critical parameters. I will switch on my laser pointer also. We have here the parameter like for wastewater COD in example. You can see we have the existing standard here, which is 150 milligram in this case. When we want to discharge into inland water, so this limit is also at 150. When we discharge here into a sewage treatment plant, in this case, you can even extend the limit to 400. And when the customers in Pakistan want to discharge to sea, then you have also a limit of 150. So the regulation depends a little bit also on where to discharge. So what is the standard, but also if you are discharging to a sewage plant, then the limit in example could be higher. We have here the phenolic compounds here, as you can see it with a 0.1 milligram here, 0.3 milligram when we discharge into a treatment plant. We have parameters like fluoride. This is a requirement from heavy metal industry also, that this need to be monitored. Of course, the cyanide, we have it available here. Sulfate is not a critical parameter, but this is also something. Ammonia, of course, pesticides, a couple of more. As you can see also here, and we have here some additional parameters here, like the metals, the cadmium, the chromium, the copper. As you can see it here, selenium, nickel, and some more. So you can see quite some more also, which are here mentioned, what we need to monitor. Just one example. I have chosen another sample from Vietnam, wastewater industrial discharge standard also. This is up-to-date standard also. And you can see here, they have also different type of requirements here from the different type of industry segment. So where's the discharge? So if it's a class A water, a class B water, where to discharge, or a class C water. This is how it's split. In principle, relatively same like what you saw from Pakistan. You can see here the COD, a very important parameter here will be at 50 milligram. For the class B water, it is 100, and for a class C water, it is a 400 milligram. You can see arsenic, cadmium, lead, residual chlorine, because often they use chlorine for disinfection of the wastewater, the chromium 6 and the chromium 3, very toxic metals also. But here's some more. You can see it here with the nickel, phosphorus, also a very important parameter. You can see here the limit is 4 milligram, 6 milligram, and 8 milligram. It depends on the discharge, where the discharge, the total nitrogen. It's also an important parameter for the wastewater. It's a 15, 30 and 60 milligram ammonia as N is nitrogen, 5 milligram, 10 milligram and 50 milligram. So it depends really on the requirement. And this makes sense, of course, because when you have a treatment plant which is treating this water, then you can even provide a wastewater which is less good in the quality because it will be treated, of course, at the end. This is a functionality and so things make sense. Now, when we look for drinking water, a topic for today also in the same presentation also is, I want to show you also some examples. And therefore I choose the WHO, the US and the EU directive. And when we, please mute your microphone, it disturbs a little bit. So when we look to the international regulation, WHO, US and EU, you can also see that we have some approximate values and limit values. We do the monitoring according to typically local regulation, of course, but when we look here for the US EPA in example, they also accept alternative test procedures because there is a regulation in the United States available also, which allows also to use slightly modified methods. When we look for the EU, in this case, it's even completely different because here we have some quality standards which are accepted, which need to be met. This is what all member states can use these parameters also according to the guidelines here from the human health.
Sorry, Gunther, I'm going to interrupt you for a bit just to change. May I please request that everybody turn off your camera and mute the mic so that the presentation can be clearly heard by everybody. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Asanga. So we have the possibilities that we use alternative test procedures also that is officially allowed since many years. And today you will see it later in the presentation also, you have the requirements for the measurement of the uncertainty to calculate the uncertainty to be able to use this method for reporting reasons. Even for reporting reasons, we are flexible that we can choose any kind of method. And this is relatively the same principle also in the United States. You can see also that there are further developments ongoing to accept more of those alternative test procedures. And now when we look to the comparison table, this is what I have made here as a very short extract where we have the WHO guideline, the US EPA methods limits also and the EU limits here. That is the latest update from December 2020. And you can see, of course, when we talk about drinking water parameters like aluminium, but also here ammonium is not always specified. You can see it here. We have a limit in the EU. Other important parameters like the bromate, in example, which is toxic, of course, where we have a 0.01 milligram. We have the chlorine is not specified here in some of the limitations because it is used, so chlorine, of course, you can also see here typically 0.2 milligram up to 4 milligram. It depends very much on the regulation. In Europe, we have a special directive for the disinfection parameters. This is why you don't find it in the EU directive directly, but of course, parameters like the chromium, the copper, you can see the cyanide also, iron, a very important parameter, not because of toxicity, but because of the taste. The same is the manganese also, that is also a very important parameter and of course clear nitrate and some others also. And this is all what we are required, what we need to measure of course. It was a short overview about the requirement from the regulation. And now let's have a look into the advantage and disadvantage of a normative method. So when we talk about a normative method, we talk here about the ISO standard, the European standard, the AFA or US EPA methods. All these methods are globally available and these methods are approved methods. So we are talking here about information from basic quality data and basic information in the interferences, which are tested also, which are described in the standard. And when we look for the results of these normative methods, the advantage of course is that this could be used for reporting. So if we have a requirement for a wastewater testing, often we have, of course, we have also sometimes local standards. So we have a local standard available or the countries are following ISO or AFA or US EPA because of the easy access. And then we can, of course, use these results for reporting. That is a big advantage. When we look for the new developed ISO standards, we have a lot of new standards also. This fulfills a lot of QC documentation. QC documentation is a must as a part of the standard, that you have an information how accurate this method is. And this is why typically also you have the information from the interlaboratory ring trial available also, and this must match the acceptance criteria also, which are available also from the ISO working committee. When we talk about the disadvantage of such a normative method, means that we are talking about a lot of working steps, because you have to see that we have to prepare our reagents, which we use for the method itself. Often we are talking about liquids, sometimes maybe also a powder mixture, whatever. We have to prepare our solutions, which we use for the measurement. And of course, we have to use also some standards, because we need to do a calibration. So calibration must be done from the user in the laboratory. Everybody must, the laboratory must do an own calibration. And in theory also, but also in practice, every user should also run own calibration. So if you have 5 users in the laboratory, you have to check that this is done properly also. That is very important. And when we talk about not used reagents, because often you have to prepare a 0.5 liter of volume or whatever, often not used reagents must be discharged proper also. And this means also that this is becoming very time consuming and also money consuming. This is also involved because of discharging, in example. And this is when we talk about normative methods, they are in summary mostly very time consuming. What is not available here is, and this is under the responsibility of the laboratory, the entire QC protocol, like certificates or calibration of the methods, these are not available. This is fully in the responsibility of the laboratory. So if your auditor is asking, please show me your calibration, this is then you have to show this calibration, this is a must. If you are not able to do this, then you can't use the method. Or if somebody is working with this method also, which is not qualified, which is he is not certified here, accepted also for this method, then he cannot use it. So this is a completely procedure also, which is established also to assure the quality of the results, and that the people in the laboratory are able to use this method. That is all behind. This is when we talk about a normative method. Now let's talk about what is the difference between a normative method and a spectroquant method. I call it here the Merck spectroquant rapid methods. In Germany, we talk here officially about an alternative test procedure, because we have procedures established already in 1990, in example, that we officially can use rapid methods for reporting, in example, when we talk about wastewater testing. And it's the same also when we look for the EU directive, this allows us also to use rapid methods. So it's not the case that this is not precise. That's not the topic at all. When we talk about the Merck methods, 80% of the Merck methods are identical to the normative methods. I can give you an example. So we are talking here about the spectroquant kit using the same method, using the same color reaction. So they are identical. When we talk about the phosphomolybdenum blue method, this is a global standard available as an ISO, as an ARPA, and also the Merck test kit for phosphor, you will see it later, is following the phosphomolybdenum blue method. When we talk about the chromium method, the global method available also, it's the US EPA method also, is a diphenyl carbazid in example. We are using the same diphenyl carbazid in our test kit. So this is also where we have got a new EPA acceptance also. So we are talking about the same chemistry. But what is the difference? Our intention is that we are providing less handling steps, because this means also an easier handling and it reduces error. So when you have less handling step, means automatically you have less errors. And what we do also is we want to avoid time and cost wasting steps, because this makes it more complicated also and more expensive because the time is the money. And when you look to our package inserts contains more details, also information about interference, also details here to the chemistry, everything is available. And what we want to do also is we want to reduce the waste because we don't want to dispose something if not necessary. So our test kit works. You have to take one portion out, use it for the measurement, and then you can, of course, discharge it. Now, how is this possible that we have less handling steps, that we want to avoid time cost wasting steps, in example? And this is purely because of the production know-how, what we have in Darmstadt here. We have the production facility R&D in Darmstadt sitting also, and they have gained over the last 50 years, we are producing tests more than 50 years now, a lot of know-how. We are able to produce powders. We are able to produce mixtures of powders or granulars, in example, and we know how to stabilize them. Or when we talk about liquid also, we are using liquids often also as a part of our test kit, but we are able to stabilize them. We are using technology like membrane or sterile filtration. This is in principle also something what you can do in a laboratory, sure, of course, but it is expensive. If you do it for a half liter, your cost would be exploding. But if I do the same in Darmstadt for 1,000 liter, then it will be a completely different type of calculation. And we have a lot of know-how also to add something here, like substances, to remove, in example, interferences. Or in example, when you look to the standard methods here, you have a pH value maybe of 4 to 8. But in our test kit, you can find maybe something from 2 to 10 or something like this. In this case, we add a buffer system to make it more comfortable so that the customer don't need to do a pH adjustment. And this makes also it much easier to use a test kit chemistry, in example. When we talk about the method here, all our test kits are validated. And of course, we are using a lot of standard during the measurement when we do the development of a new test kit. But also we're using a lot of samples. So whenever we have access to samples, we are using also samples to test that the test kit is measuring accurate. So like you do it also with a different type of samples in your laboratory. All our test kits are validated. And of course, what we provide, and you can see this here in the Merck homepage also, is that we have certificates of quality available for every item, for every batch, for every item. And for every batch, we have even a lot certificate available here, and you can download this here in the homepage. You can find them. You can just enter on the homepage the item number and the batch number. The batch number is on the box. You will see it later also, and you can download this lot certificate and certificate of quality. So we are providing you the entire quality documentation, of course, from our people in Darmstadt. And what you need to do, of course, is the same as when we talk about the normative method, sometimes, of course, run a standard, clear. But it's logical. But the entire validation that is done in our photometers, this is coming automatically with the photometers. So it is much more easy, much less handling. This is the difference when we talk about a Merck spectroquant and a normative method. Hope that it's getting clear. Now let's have a look, because we look for photometric analysis, we need to understand our spectroquant chemistry. Now when we talk about our spectroquant chemistry, we have two different types of test kit principles. One is a spectroquant cell test kit, and one is when we talk about a spectroquant reagent test kit. Do you know what this means? I want to clarify a little bit also that we have the same understanding. Let's have a look. What is a spectroquant cell test kit? When I'm talking here in the presentation and the cell test kit, you can see it here. It's a phosphate in example for the measurement of the orthophosphate and total phosphorus. For a COD, we would use also a cell test kit here. When I'm talking here about a cell test kit, please remember, this is this box of styropor labeled here. According to GSS, this is a highly convenient and user-friendly product because this box contains 25 tubes, like you can see them here. That is an example here for the phosphorus. All have a GSS label, like you can see on the outside box here, but also every single tube have a GSS label. You can see here a barcode reading system. This is a 2D barcode for identifying. This is providing batch number, shelf life, and everything. And the preparation of the sample and the measurement will be done in this tube. So you can see here, this tube is pre-filled. We are adding the sample, we are adding some additional chemistry, like you have it here, maybe available here for the phosphate. The P1K is a digestion reagent for the adjustment of the pH value. We take the P2K, and for the color reaction later on, we would use the P3K. You can see we have different type of dosing systems here. We are using here dosing caps. They are part of the box. And the blue is related to the blue cap, and the green, of course, to the green. And the black one here is a drop counting bottle, where we have a dropper inbuilt in the box. So everything is highly convenient, very user-friendly, and you can't do anything wrong because every tube is barcode treated. So when I'm talking about a SpectroQuant cell test kit, please keep in mind that we are talking about this box, 25 tubes pre-filled. Very easy from the handling. Perfect. Let's have a look into the reagent test kit, because you know that we are talking about wastewater analysis, also drinking water, and you will see some examples where we use also a reagent test kit. So when I'm talking about the SpectroQuant reagent test kit, we are talking about an inexpensive but also ready to use mixture, also user friendly. But it is a little bit different from the handling. I'm talking here about this cardboard box, also with a label where you can find the item number, batch number, expiry date, everything on this label. You can find here these tubes, these bottles here. You can find also the auto selector. You can see this here. This is all coming, that is an example for ammonium, and where we can measure here with different type of cells. We are using here rectangular cells, classical rectangular cells, like we have them in the laboratory available, or you can get them also from us. 10 millimeter, 20 millimeter, 50 millimeter, and even the 100 millimeter cell. When we want to measure very sensitive, then we can also measure in 100 millimeter. All the bottles have a GSS labeling, as you can see it here, and the auto selector. This is auto selector. This is what we call for the automatically selection of methods. So therefore, we add the auto selector. You will see it later also here how it works. This is also coming with the box. With this advantage of using the different type of cells, we can measure very low, especially when we talk about drinking water here in the PBB range, using the 50 millimeter cell. So in many cases, when we talk about drinking water, or when we talk about low levels also for phosphate or ammonium, in example, in wastewater, we would also choose maybe a 50 millimeter cell to measure very sensitive also. And the advantage also is that these test kits are used like taking one portion out, like the cell test kit in principle also is the same, and preparing the sample and measuring the sample in the rectangular cell. But this, of course, as we are using them for, these rectangular cells are for multiple usage, this drops the costs. This is why I said here at the beginning, you remember, it is inexpensive, it's much less expensive compared to, in example, to a cell test kit. Because we are doing a little bit more handling steps, we have more flexibility, but of course this is dropping the cost because we don't need to use always a cell test kit. A big advantage also is a long shelf life, typically 3 years, so 2 to 3 years, and we don't need to store any kind of our test kit, also the cell test, not in a fridge. So you can keep them normally in your laboratory. Should be in a range between 15 and 25 degrees. Also in summertime, 30 degrees will not have a big impact on the chemistry. But this is when we talk about the SpectroQuant reagent test kit. Very important to understand, remember, using the auto selector, using the rectangular cells. Let's have a look into the instruments. When we talk about the SpectroQuant product line, I'm not talking only about the instrument. You will see it also. Instrument, of course, is a very important part where we have the proof instruments, we have the move instruments, the thermoreactors in example, the digester, which we use for the COD measurement for total nitrogen, total phosphorus. Of course, a part, very important part, are the test kits itself, but also everything for the standards which we provide, because in many cases we provide ready-to-use standards also, which we need to what we do for the quality control. Accessories, of course, are available, like the rectangular cells. You can find also many other things what is typically needed also in the laboratory and in the Sigma-Aldrich homepage also. And what is also important, or what could be important, is connectivity, so that we have the possibility to download the data from a proof, in example, to a USB stick, to import them into Excel, in example, or even connectivity by Proof Connect to a LIMS soft LIMS system. Also, this is all possible. So we are talking here about our complete system. And this is, of course, compromising from the different type of parts. It's the instruments, chemistry, all around. This makes it complete. When we look for different type of special cases, like when we talk about drinking water, but also for wastewater, we have here the MOVE-DC, it's a small handheld, perfect for production control. When we talk about chlorine, ozone, those type of things. But also when we talk about a small portable laboratory here for drinking water, but also for wastewater here, for COD measurement, in example, we could also, in example, take a MOVE-100, so a small portable instrument also, which can do more than 100 different type of methods. So it's a flexible, small, cheap also instrument. We will have a look into it. Now, of course, this presentation will focus mostly on the SpectroQuant proof photometers, where we have three instruments. You can see it here, the proof 100 as a WIS instrument from 320 to 1100 nanometers. The proof 300 also a UV WIS 190 nanometers. That's of course an advantage if you want to measure also in the UV range. And we have the 600, also a UV vest, but 1.8 nanometer instead of 4 nanometer. So we have this different type of instruments available, and you can see that we have different type of routine applications for these three instruments. So the proof 100 is a typical instrument what you could do perfectly for wastewater analysis. It will do all this measurement, all the test kits. And of course, you can also use it as a routine photometer for routine applications for own measurements, because you can do 100 own measure or own methods. You can enter 100 own methods into the machine. So you can use all the SpectroQuant test kit, but of course, this is a WIS instrument. The proof 300 is our UV WIS, perfect for wastewater, but also for drinking water, especially when we talk about the application, in example, to measure the UV radiation. Could be an interesting point. In this case, of course, it is a must to have a UVV spectrophotometer. And the proof 600 is a high-end instrument here, where we can measure ultra-sensitive using even 100 millimeter cell. So this is the most sensitive and a 1.8 nanometer. So we have different type of classes of photometer for the different type of demands. Let's show have a look for a short video to look for the handling. Now I need to look how I get it started. Ah, here.
Gunther, is there sound on the video?
Sorry?
Is there any sound on the video?
Yes. Did you? You are not able to listen.
No, we cannot hear. So maybe you need to narrate it. Yeah.
Yeah. Then we will skip it. Sorry, I did not realize that you don't get the, because I was hearing the sound. Sorry for that. Okay. Yeah, it was a video. You can hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, fine. The video was just showing a little bit also what I want to show you here in the pictures and explain also. This was a video about the handling of the different type of test kits. You remember we said the cell test kit. When we look here for the handling here, we have here the cell test port. So we have a very nice technology integrated in the proof instrument. We're talking here about the cell test port here. You have here the mark here, the dot on the photometer. You have here this alignment mark also here, and when you align this, as you will see it here in the next picture, in this picture also here, when you align this mark here and you push the cell down, it will read automatically the barcode. So you can see here, the barcode here in the shaft is a CCD camera inbuilt. It will read the barcode when you push it down also. And then what the photometer will do automatically, it will start the measurement automatically. It will show the relevant information in the display as you can see it here. This is the measurement for the ammonium. You can see the result. You can see here also where you are within the mission range. So if you are in the middle range, like here in example, or more above or more below. And you can see the citation form here, and you can see the unit here. And this is something in example what you can easily switch here from ammonium nitrogen to ammonium, or the milligram in ppm, or maybe sometimes even in millimole. So this is all what you can see here on the display. So this is done automatically just by pushing the tube into the photometer. We'll identify the entire calibration. This is all known from the photometer and will measure fully automatically. It's very easy also, and this is what the video was showing. Sorry for that. When we talk about the spectroquant reagent test kits, our second chemistry where we use rectangular cells. In this case, it is the first time that we need to open the shaft here, like you can see it here. With the cell test, you don't need to do anything, just with some instrument on. But when we use rectangular cells here, we need to open the shaft for the instruments. You can see it here. We are using the auto selector. This is coming automatically with the box. And this is for identifying the parameter. So you place the auto selector at this point also, align this also. So the CCD camera, which is sitting here below, will read the barcode and will switch already to the article here, to the item number. And then you just place the rectangular cells here into the photometer. And we have a specialty inbuilt. And this is what I want to show you and explain to you because it's unique. This is an example from the ammonium reagent test kit. You saw this cardboard box. This is our ammonium reagent test kit. And this is a package insert, which is also the manual page, which is coming, which is describing in the manual, also a part of the manual. And you can see the description here of the handling, as you can see this here. And here you can see the different type of measuring ranges and different type of citation units. So you can see we can use a 10 millimeter, the 20 millimeter and a 50 millimeter cell. And we can select the cell depending on the sample. So when we talk about the handling itself, it is always the information available, what is the pH value of the sample, which we can measure. You can see here from 4 to 13, there is no need for adjusting the pH in this range. You add 5 milliliter of the sample into a test tube. You add 0.6 milliliter of ammonium reagent 1, 1 microspoon of the reagent number 2. You have to shake. You have to wait for 5 minutes. You add 4 drops of ammonium reagent number 3. You have to wait for another 5 minutes. Then you transfer the sample in your rectangular cell, and then you place the auto selector into the photometer, you enter the cell into the shaft for the rectangular cells at the correct position, and then the photometer will measure fully automatically. Also with the reagent test kit. And the key here for this measurement and to assure the security of the result is what you can see here. We have a special adapter-less and automatically optical mechanical cell size recognition system inbuilt in the photometer. We have here the lamp, we have here the shaft for the rectangular cells, where we can enter the 10 millimeter, 20 or 50 millimeter cell. And you can see here, we have micro switches inbuilt, well, it's a mechanical, but automatically optomechanical system. So when we place a 10 millimeter in the shaft, we are touching, and we are doing this at the correct position, we are touching the micro switch number 1. Micro switch number 2 and 3 and 4 are not in contact with the cuvette because the 10 millimeter is just at the correct place here. And in this case, when we would use the 10 millimeter cells, the ammonium measurement will be done here in the range of 0.05 to 3 milligram. So it's a little bit higher range. If we want to measure now lower ranges for wastewater, drinking water in example, and would use a more sensitive range here from 0.010 up to 0.5 milligram only, we would use a 50 millimeter cell. And you can see here in this case, we have the position of the 50 millimeter cell. In this case, these three micro switches have contact and signal to the photometer. This must be a 50 millimeter cell. And the photometer will switch automatically to correct cell size and to the correct measurement range and will do the measurement automatically in this measurement range. If you would use here for the 20 millimeter a wrong position in example, that you would have a contact with cell micro switch number 3 and number 4 and not with number 1 and number 2, the instrument will tell you this is an unclear situation because it's not the correct position, neither maybe a correct cell, and will not do the measurement. And because of this adapterless automatically cell size recognition system, we can measure very broad, as you can see it here, from 0.010 up to 3 milligram. And this is also exactly the measurement range. And this is an advantage as we are using different type of cell sizes when we talk about the reagent test kit. We can measure less sensitive, more sensitive, but you can't do anything wrong because the instrument will identify the cell size automatically. And this is something which is totally unique and will make your life much more easy. So when we talk about this reagent test kit, it is also very user-friendly, but also very safe because of this adapterless automatically cell size recognition system. Now let's have a look into the information we saw in the video. Sorry for not having the tone available here. We are using here for the identification for the tubes, as you can see them here, but also for the auto selector. This is what we call a live ID barcode. And this live ID barcode provides you additional information like the lot number, which you can typically find on the box. The expiry date also you can find on the box, but this is also coming automatically by this live ID barcode. It is identifying automatically the number from the method and it knows the complete calibration. And in example, when we have a change also here because of change of raw material, you know, in a moment we have a lot of problems with raw materials because of different type of sources. In this case, we can even do a calibration update fully automatically. So the customers are getting always the best calibration, which we are proving in Darmstadt, also in our QC laboratory. This is all provided from the live ID barcode here, what you can see here. And this makes it very unique because you have an entire control about the entire chemistry. And you can see the photometers are quite flexible because we are using the 2D barcode, which you can see on the cell test kits, we have it on the auto selector. And here you remember how to position the cuvette correctly. And here, so you can see the usage also of the rectangular cells, the 50 millimeter here. And when we want to use a 100 millimeter cell, you place the auto selector in, you remove it, you remove this part of the shaft. This is possible with the Proof 600. So you can remove this part and you can open up the instrument and also here you can even enter 100 millimeter cells for ultra-sensitive measurements. In example, we made a publication for ultra-sensitive measurement for iron, for drinking water in example. Very important, when we launched the Proof photometers, we had a huge discussion about the smart screen. We have implemented a smart screen, which is completely easy to navigate, as you can see it here on the next page also. And you will see all the important information here, the date, the time, the entire documentation you can all see here in the display. And now when we talk about the navigation, we are talking here about the graphic user interface, a GUI. And the entire photometer is navigated from these two bars. You have here the methods, we have here the setting of the methods. We can do some ad hoc measurement like a scanning or whatever. The entire quality assurance, so we have a huge support inbuilt in the machine from quality assurance. This is what you can find under this icon. The results, so the machine stores 2000 data. You can select the results according to date, to time, to users in example also. We have here the system setting, so everything for the date, time, language, and example. And you have here login and logout for the users and for administrators. And we have even timers. And by pressing this bar here, this menu bar, as you can see them here, you are switching just from this bar to this one, and this will change. So with this easy navigation, you can do the entire navigation of the machine. And here you have the information bar. If you want to see some more details to the method, to the results, to lot information in example, you can just open up this, you press on this information bar, and this is window is popping up and you can see more details for your measurement in example. So it's very easy to use. And very important also, does it sometimes happen that you have some spillage? Yes, of course, it happens. Yeah. And this is why we have constructed the proof in such a way that we can remove here the the cell holder here for the round cell and the rectangular cells. We have a drainage system inbuilt. You can see this here. We have a bottom here at the instrument, a hole. So when you have some spillage, the water, the liquid will go out of the drainage system at down in the bottom, will not touch any kind of PCB board or whatever. It's not possible also because of the construction. You are totally safe. You just take it out, you clean it underwater, you dry it, and you can take it back. So it's a totally easy cleaning. So spillage is not a problem at all for us. Let's have a look into the spectroquantum chemistry. Very important for our measurements today. I have chosen some examples, important parameters here for wastewater. Let's have first of all a look into the wastewater analysis. We talk here about the ISO 15705, the standard which we have introduced for COD cell test kit. It's a global standard available already since nearly 20 years. What we have done at that time also, I was a member of the delegation here, which implemented this standard also. And all our test kits, you can see them here on this document. You can find this in the internet also in our homepage. We are confirming that all our commercial available COD test kits are fulfilling the requirements here from the ISO 15705. So this is, you can see I signed it also at that time when I was a product manager also. We are providing this certificates of conformity for all our mission ranges. This is all mentioned. Now, why did we establish the ISO 15705? In former times, it was frequently used when we talk about COD measurements, the ISO 6060. And one reason, of course, we are talking here about the ISO 6060, about the open refraction and titration method. When we look for the chemistry, you can see, of course, it is the same chemistry. Both methods are using mercury sulfate, silver sulfate, potassium dichromate, which is highly toxic, carcinogenic, like nothing. Of course, sulfuric acid and the entire waste volume. And this is what we have mentioned here. The red one here is a COSD standard according to ISO 15705. The yellow one is a quantity which we need for the open reflux titration. And when we look here for the open flux titration, we need to use 400 milligram of mercury sulfate. Highly toxic carcinogenic. Silver sulfate is a catalysator, 150 milligram. 60 milligram potassium dichromate, which you need to use a balance also for weighting. 50 milliliter of sulfuric acid. And the total waste volume after titration, you can estimate, will be in a range of 110 to 150 milliliter. When you look for the same chemistry here, but it is from the ISO 15705, it's only 80 milligram on mercury sulfate, 30 milligram on silver. So everything also here, only 15 milligram on potassium dichromate. And of course you don't need to prepare because this is coming with a closed tube. So you don't have any kind of handling of toxic chemistry. And this makes life much more easy, much more better because of safety reasons. You have no exposure for the people. The waste volume here in totally will be only 5.2 milliliter. So it's totally different. And this was a reason because we know that the results from commercial available COD test kits are absolutely accurate. This is also what the ring trial, the interlaboratory ring trial was showing also, a good comparison of the measurement results. And this is the main reason to avoid toxic waste and exposure for the people in the laboratory. When we look here for the method for the photometric measure itself, and I'm showing here user overview about the Merck portfolio, the measure ranges. We are talking here about two different type of methods. One here, when we talk about these lower measure ranges, we're talking here about the measurement of the unconsumed yellow dichromate concentration. This is when we have a yellow color in the cuvette. And we are talking here about a negative gradient, so a negative calibration. You can see we have the different type of item numbers here. We have different type of ranges, measure ranges here. And we are gaining the sensitivity because of, in example, different type of wavelengths, like you can see it here, from 340 and 445 nanometers. So the chemistry like this one here and this one is relatively identical. It is more or less a wavelength. You can see that we are using sometimes different type of samples volumes, like 3 milliliter, 2 milliliter, 3 milliliter also here. And you can see here even the chloride tolerances. So when we have this portfolio also, it is very much important that generally when we talk about COD measurement, we avoid dilutions. Dilutions always is increasing the error. So whenever possible, please choose a different type of test kit where we use different type of potassium dichromate concentrations, of course, but also different type of wavelengths and different type of pipetting volumes. When we look here for the higher ranges, you can see them here. So from 25 to 1500 milligram, 100 to 300 to 3500, or even from 5000 to 90000, so the very high ranges. We are talking about the method of the measurement of the increase of the chromium 3 concentration. In this case, we are talking about a positive gradient. You can see we are using also here different type of wavelength compared to the lower, to the yellow method, and here different type of pipetting volumes. And also here you can see we have different type of chloride tolerances from 2000 milligram up to 5000 or even to 50000. And this method corresponds to ISO 15705, all these methods are analog to EPA and to the ALPHA. So our test kits, we have got also for all our test kits the EPA equivalency and corresponds then to ISO 15705. Why do we have such a lot of different type of ranges? That's very easy because we have at the customers different type of samples that we need to analyze. And the key issue, and this is what I want to show is with this slide, is that is what we call about the error tubes. So every method has an error, or when we talk about the accuracy of the methods, as you can see them here. So when we want to measure relatively low concentrations for drinking water, in example, we would use a 4 to 40 milligram because the accuracy is a 0.5 milligram. When we have wastewater here in a range of 150 milligram, 200 milligram, you can see here the 15 to 300 milligram range could be perfect with an accuracy of only 8 plus minus 8 milligram. When we have a wastewater which we want to measure in a inlet, here maybe we have a 300 to 3500 or 500 to 10,000 milligram. It depends, of course, yeah, on the water coming to the plant. In this case, we have different type of accuracies. And it is always the best to choose a test kit according to the requirement from the sample. So when you want to measure a sample which is relatively close to 150 milligram and use a 10 to 150 milligram range, it can be that your sample is out of the range, maybe at 170 or maybe at 130, then it's fine. But if you're out at this range, you can't measure. So in this case, you can see maybe the 15 to 300 milligram range can be a good advantage. Or when we talk about a wastewater which is in a range maybe from 1000, 1500, sometimes maybe also 2000 milligram. Here in this case, when you have 1500, 1000 milligram, you are still perfectly in this range. Of course, you will get an accurate result. But if you are at 2000 milligram, it means you have to double, you have to do a dilution. And this means you have to do a double measurement. You have to do another COD while, but in this case also here, it might be useful to take the 300 to 3500 milligram. So it depends very much on the requirement from the customers, and this is why we introduce all these different type of ranges. Let's have a look how the tube is handled. This is a good example from the range from 25 to 1500 milligram. We are taking the tube, we are shaking the tube, you open the tube at 3 mL of the sample, you close the tube, you shake it vigorously, then you place it into the thermoreactor for 2 hours at 148 degrees typically. After finishing the reaction time or the heating time here, you remove the cell, place it in a cell holder rack. 10 minutes after putting the tube into the rack, you take it out and squeal it also for just a few seconds also, then replace it back also, you cool it down to room temperature and then you put it into the photometer and get the result. So you can see COD can be very easy. No handling from chemistry, no balance needed, no toxic chemistry because everything is coming with a tube pre-filled, totally easy. Let's have a look into another important parameter. It is for drinking water, but also for wastewater analysis here, where we talk about the phosphate measurement today. We have here the different type of photometric measurements. Of course, we have different type of methods. ISP, in example, you can measure the phosphate. We have ion gram-gray flow injection analysis, continuous flow analyzers, but many photometric measurements. And as I mentioned already, the alpha method here is phosphomolybdenum blue. The EPA also is molybdenum blue. The ISO is also molybdenum blue. So even the local standards, which you might have available, also is phosphomolybdenum blue. We have a separate standard here in the alpha here, the 45P, the appendix C. In this case, we are talking about the molybdovanadate phosphoric acid. Don't use it for drinking water and for wastewater. This is measuring the hydrolyzed phosphate, like what we need in example in cooling and boiler water. And this would give higher results because of a higher quantity on the sulfuric acid. Therefore, the method for wastewater and drinking water more phosphomolybdenum blue method. When we look here to our test kits following the phosphomolybdenum blue method, you can see we have different type of cell test kits, as you can see them here, from 0.05 to 5 mg, from 3 mg to 100 mg. And as a reagent test kit where we can measure sensitive, which is required more for drinking water, for lower ranges, sometimes also for wastewater, we have it reagent test kits from 0.010 to 5 and from 1 to 100. And when we want to measure the total phosphorus, what is required, you can see even here we have 3 cell test kits, which can do this. And we will have a look into it, how phosphor measurement can be done. You remember our picture from the cell test kit, what I showed at the beginning here. So the polystyrene box is a perfect protection from temperature and for transportation. So we have the 2D barcode system. We have the reagents here, the powder reagent here for the dosing cap, the reagent one. The reagent two, which is a dilute, is a drop counting bottle here for the adding of the acid. And here the P3K reagent is a color reagent. So everything is ready to come with this box. Now, when we talk about the measurement of autophosphate, this is what we need to do also when we measure the phosphate in total, also the total phosphorus. We have the different type of citation norms, as you can see here, typically for wastewater, for the outlet, we would use the lower range from 0.05 to 5 milligram. You often have a value to measure maybe in a range of 1 milligram, 2 milligram, 4 milligram, something like this. It depends on the region, on the country, on the requirement for the discharge. You can find here the information about the pH value. You can see here from 0 to 10, no adjustment is needed, typically good for our wastewater, drinking water. You take 5 liters of the sample, you put this into the reaction cell, you add 5 drops of the P2K reagents, 1 dose of the P3K reagents, you shake it, you have to wait for 5 minutes, and then you place the cell into the cell compartment of your proof instrument, and this will read automatically the result and show it in the display. You can see very easy how to measure the autophosphate. Now let's have a look for the measurement of the total phosphorus. In this case, of course, we need to do the digestion because when we want to calculate here the total phosphorus, we need to convert, first of all, everything in the digestion also to autophosphates that we can measure later it at autophosphate. But actually we are measuring the total phosphorus. This is here also why we take 500 of samples. We add one dose of P to 1K reagents, our digestion reagents. This is a potassium peroxide sulfate. We place this in the thermoreactor for 120 degrees for 30 minutes. Then we remove the cell, cool it down to room temperature, add 5 drops of 2 reagent P minus 2K. And then we add one dose of P minus 3K to the cuvette also. We shake it. We have to wait for 5 minutes. Then we place the cuvette here into the photometer and get the results. Now, when we want to know what is the content of our sample in case of autophosphor, in this case, we measure the autophosphate. As you can see it here, we measure the total phosphorus. This measures the summary from the organophosphor and the autophosphate. And then we calculate the P total minus the autophosphate is the organophosphorus. And our organophosphorus, as you can see this here, is can be the 3-phosphates, 3-phosphates, polyphosphates or phosphonates in example. All this will be digested from the total phosphorus. This is a measurement what we will do here. And the total minus the auto will be the organophosphorus. When we want to measure the total phosphorus without any details, it is good enough to do this measurement. But when you want to know what is the content of your organophosphorus, you just measure the autophosphate and the total. And you subtract the auto from the total and you have the organo. Very easy to do. Now, on our package insert, and this is also what I want to show you, you have information about foreign substances which can interfere. And this information, what you can see here on the screen, is everything what does not interfere. So here you have the arsenic, mercury, other, and of course for COD, this can not interfere, but it can disturb the measurement. And this is why we have the additional information about what is a COD value, because when we talk about the usage of peroxodisulfate, this is also consumed from COD. And therefore, this is the information, what is the typical value of COD in your samples. And when you add 2 doses, as you see it here below, the maximum COD tolerance is 300 milligram for the range up to 5 milligram. If you would have too much COD, in this case, of course, you have to dilute the sample maybe 1 by 1 or something to come in this typical value, because at the end, we need still to have some potassium peroxide sulfate left, that we have enough digestion capacity available to digest phosphate. This is why this information, and you can find those information always in the package inserts, is very important. And of course, a part of the system is also the quality assurance. So we created a complete system here for the quality assurance where we talk about the CombiCheck 10. This is a test kit also ready to use where we can do some control measurements. But we have introduced also our ready to use phosphate standard from the 30PUR line, where you have concentrations typically from 1000 milligram, which you further dilute, of course, then after this. This is, in example, a standard which you would use when you talk about the calibration, if you need to do your own calibration, in example. And we have also introduced different type of certified reference materials here, also here in example, for the measurement of the total phosphorus. And for this range, especially here, we have a low range certified reference material and a higher range, so that you can also use this. And this is for the total phosphorus, means including digestion. Specification is available also, so we have a huge variation of quality standards which we provide to do the entire quality control, because it is a very important topic when we talk about also assuring our results. And of course, in example, also when your auditor is asking what type of material are you using here, certified reference standards, this is our own prepared standard also. In this case, of course, it is required to use always the highest quality of standards, like a CRM standard for your quality documentation. And this is why we are providing these standards in example. This is a bit more detail available, also information about the CRM standards here. You can see here the order number, you can see the concentration here, you can see the uncertainty. Of course, it is very important, the expanded measurement uncertainty here. This is a composition of the standard. You can see here, this is for the total phosphorus, a turbinal standard. The pH value, where the standard is, does it have here? The package size, we are talking here about this 100 milliliter sample of volumes of these bottles and for which test kit is suitable. So in our catalog, you can find this overview here for all the parameters. And this is an example of such a picture of the total phosphorus standard also here. The big advantage, of course, when we talk about this ready-to-use certified reference materials is that we are talking here about the control of the total phosphorus digestion without any dilution. So these standards here, like you can see them here, are ready to use. So you open the bottle, you can use it also here. There is no dilution required. The certified reference materials are ready to use and made for the test kit in this range. Of course, we can use it also for control of any kind of standard method like ARPA, EPA, doesn't matter. But these, of course, are specially made also. And the concentrations here in example, you can see on the screen, are implemented as one of the quality parts already in the photometer. So you can easily select your item number, your certified reference material, and the photometer knows all the details. Very nice, very easy to do. Let's have a look into the total nitrogen, a very important parameter also for wastewater. In this case, we have two test kits, which are using the 2,6-dimethylphenol method here. This is according, the digestion is done according to the ISO 11905 part 1. And the nitrate measurement is done according to the German DIN. Please mute your microphone.
Aujal, whatever lot of test chalche na kire.
Please mute your microphone. Thank you. The entire conditions for the digestion is 120 degrees at 60 minutes digestion time. So when we look here for an example, then I want just to show you one range here, so 0.5 to 50 milligrams. So typically for the outlet of a wastewater plant, it is very easy from the handling. We are taking 10 milliliters of a sample into an empty cell, adding one microspoon of N-1K to the cell, adding 6 drops, and this is alkaline to the cuvette. We heat the sample here, of course we close the cuvette here, we heat the sample at 120 degrees for 1 hour, then we remove it, and that is what we call a pre-treated sample. We squill it after 10 minutes, then we are taking from this pre-treated sample 1 milliliter in the cell for the cell test kit, adding 1 milliliter of the liquid reagent here, the 2,6-dimethyl N-3K, that is our liquid reagent here, having 10 minutes reaction time, and then we place the cell into the photometer and do the measurement. You can see the digestion and the measurement is totally easy here from the handling for the total nitrogen measurement, so TNB. Let's have a look for some parameters for drinking water, because our topic is not only wastewater for today, but also when we talk about chlorine measurement. So the free chlorine and the total chlorine, especially the total, is also something for wastewater, because in many countries also, chlorine is added also to the wastewater. We are talking here typically about 10 milliliters of a sample, a microspoon of reagent number 1. We shake it, we have to wait for 1 minute, transfer it into the cell, placing the outer selector. This is the reagent test kit, therefore we place the outer selector in the shaft and adding the cell into the cell compartment, and we will do the measurement of the free chlorine. And with the total in principle the same, in this case we have just 2 reagents, 1 powder, 1 drop. We have to add 2 drops of reagent number 2, also 1 minute reaction time, and then we can measure the free and the total chlorine. So you can see this is very easy. So when we talk about tap water, where we use chlorine for disinfection, of course, or in this case, we are talking about this measurement, very easy. You can do this in the laboratory. And we remember at the beginning, I showed also the MOVE DC, the portables also, which where you can do the measurement also in the field, in example. All is possible. Another important disinfection parameter is the chlorine dioxide. So when we talk about also drinking water, tap water, in many cases, also in Europe, in example, they're using often also chlorine dioxide. You can see the concentrations here for the different type of cell sizes. As you can see, the handling is always 10 milliliter of sample, 2 drops of chlorine dioxide reaction number 1, 2 minutes reaction time, 1 level microspoon reaction number 2. You have to shake, you have to wait 1 minute, and then you transfer it into the rectangular cell, place out the selector and do the measurement. Entire reaction time is 2 minutes, so it's very easy and fast. When we talk about bottled water, drinking water, of course, in bottles, we often have the ozone available. It's the same also chemistry, also using the DBD method. You can see also here 10 milliliter of sample, 2 drops of reagent 1, 1 microspoon of reagent 2. You have to shake, we have to wait for 1 minute, and then we can do the measurement. And we can measure quite sensitive also the ozone concentration down to 0.010 up to 4 milligram. So you can see this measurement is very easy. Let's have a look for a very important measurement, manganese. And in this case, I want to show you two different type of test kits because we have different type of chemistry. We have here a pack size of 250 and here from this formaldehyde, so the PAN, we have one box, one test kit with 250 tests. From the others, has historical reasons, we have two pack sizes, 250 and 500. Formaldehyde. You can see here the information about the method here, what is behind the PAN measurement, and here you can see the same here from the formaldehyde. Now we are talking here about a red complex, a red brownish complex. You can see we are using different type of wavelengths and we have different type of measuring ranges. You can see this PAN chemistry is measuring more sensitive 0.005 to 2 milligram. And this from 0.010 to 10 milligram. So the range here is broader. What I selected here is a different type of cell sizes. So when we talk about drinking water usage, we would use a more sensitive cell because we need to measure typically 0.2, 0.3 milligram, something like this. We are using the 50 millimeter cell because we can measure more sensitive. You can see the LOD, the LOQ, this is what I calculated here, and the uncertainty, because it is a requirement here coming from the EU drinking water directive to show what is the uncertainty of the measurement. You can see here 4 reagents. So why do we have these two different type of test kits? Because this is where we can measure a bit more sensitive compared to the formaldehyde. But when we look here for the content, and this is why I want to show you it also to you, the reagent number 3 for this PAN chemistry is potassium cyanide. Of course, which is highly toxic, but we need to do this here. We need to use the potassium cyanide because of masking of the iron interferences. Because iron would interfere at the PAN chemistry at all levels, and we could not measure manganese without interference of the iron. And this is why we have to add the potassium cyanide. Not the case here when we talk about formaldehyde. So when you want to have a test kit which does not use any kind of potassium cyanide, even fulfilling the requirement from the EU directive, as you can see it from the uncertainty, in this case the formaldehyde test kit is perfect also because in this case you don't have any kind of cyanide. When we look for the handling, you can see the formaldehyde chemistry here where we have 3 reagents. Only 5 milliliter of the sample, 4 drops of manganese reagent 1. This is for a pH adjustment, 2 drops of manganese number 2. We have 2 minutes reaction time, then we have to add 3 drops of manganese number 3, 10 minutes reaction time, and then we transfer the sample into the rectangular cell, place the autoselector, put the rectangular cell into the shaft for the photometer, and we'll get the results. And when we use here the 50 millimeter cell, we can measure absolutely sensitive enough to meet even the EU drinking water directive for the manganese. When we talk here about the PAN chemistry with using the potassium cyanide, you can see we have 4 reagents. We take 8 milliliter of the sample, 1 microspoon of a powder, 2 milliliter of manganese 2, 3 drops of manganese 3, and then we have to add 0.25 milliliter of reagent number 4. We have to wait for 10 minutes, and then we transfer the solution here into a rectangular cell, place the auto selector and do the measurement. So totally easy to. Yeah, but you have to differentiate also what is about potassium cyanide. Do you want to have any kind of risk? In this case, we have both chemistry available, and then you can select them accordingly. We come to the conclusion. Now, how do we see our business? We are not just thinking in offering a product or selling products. We are offering the customers a complete package, complete solution. So when we talk about to make the things as easy as possible. So our thinking is to make life as easy as possible, to be on the safety side with our portfolio, to provide better solutions. This is an example when we have why we have the different type of chemistries for the manganese, because of the different type of requirements. And a huge topic, of course, is that we want to reduce in time and cost wasting steps. But of course, it might be not able that we are able to offer always a problem, but we kindly invite you. We have in all the countries a Merck representative, partly our own organization, partly we are working with dealers also. And you should contact them to have an open discussion with them about what do you want to measure, what is your requirements, what is your demand. And we are pretty sure that in many cases we can find a solution. And when you think about the consequences, how we are working in this portfolio also, then you can, my slogan is always, please think about, take Merck and you will sleep well. So you will be on the safety side with us. Coming at the end of the presentation, talking today about drinking water and wastewater analysis with modern photometric measurements. We talked about the instruments, the chemistry, everything. And we are at the end of the presentation. And of course, I want to give you also the chance to ask the questions. And I hope that I'm able to answer also all your questions. Thank you very much.